Well, my guest this week is former U.S. Senator Judd Gregg. With the Fiscal Cliff Talks, Gregg has taken a national role with the group Fix the Debt. Senator, thank you so much for coming in.
James, it's a pleasure. It's always nice to talk to the guru of New Hampshire politics.
I don't know American politics or anything else. But so why is this such a big deal for the average family in New Hampshire?
Because this is about the future of our children. If the United States continues on its present path, if we continue to add deficits, have deficits and add debt at the rate that we're going, we're going to end up like a banana republic. Mm-hmm. We're going to be bankrupt. There's no way we can sustain the type of debt we're putting on the books. And the government is growing at a rate that is equally unsustainable. And there is an opportunity right now, to do something about it. It doesn't come very often. A post-presidential period is a window of opportunity to govern. If it were a game of musical chairs, everybody would have their chair, except the people who didn't get one, like Mitt Romney. And everybody would know the position of power. And the intensity of the politics leading up to election is abated to some degree, although it's hard to tell that watching Washington. Plus, you have a forcing mechanism, the fiscal cliff, to get something big done. And it is in the political interest of both the Speaker of the House and the President to do it. So it's sort of a convergence of a whole series of streams that should lead to governance. And if governance can break out and we can get something big done on this debt, this country's economy will explode. We will have tremendous economic activity. And in addition, we'll be passing on to our kids a country they can afford.
So we're going to have some certainty finally, right?
Certainty is critical. It's critical.
For businesses.
Absolutely. It's critical for everybody. Mm-hmm. You know, people need to know what their taxes are. They need to know what the regulations are. They need to know how big the government's going to be and how much it's going to take out of the system to use to run the government as versus being available for people to borrow and create jobs.
Great. Senator, thanks so much for coming in. Now, you can read more about how Washington politics plays out here in the Granite State at WMUR.com/politics. That's also where you can watch an extended version of this interview, but that does it here for TV. Now back to you. Well, Senator, that about went by very, very quickly, I must say.
I want to
talk a little bit more about this debate. Are you surprised that the players are acting the way that they are, or are they acting perfectly rationally here?
Well, I have a friend who served on the commission with me who says in Washington, people say one thing, do another thing, and think another thing. There's always 4 to 5 levels of activity in anything that happens in Washington. And right now we're seeing what is a very kabuki-like dance on how you reach an agreement on extremely complex and difficult issues where there's a lot of vested political capital involved, where people have very definitive ideas, very definitive ideological positions, and they have to figure out how to mute those positions a little bit to reach compromise. Government is always accomplished through compromise in our system. We are not a parliamentary system where one party can tell the other party, we'll see you in 6 years, we're going to do what we want. We're a constitutional government of checks and balances. So as long as there's not 60 votes in the Senate and the President doesn't control the Senate with 60 votes and the House, You've got to work across the aisle.
What is the biggest intractable problem here? Is it 60 votes? There's been a lot of conversation about the tax pledge to Grover Norquist. I mean, what's the biggest intractable part that's why we're at right now?
Well, right now, because the Speaker has given on the tax issue, the biggest problem is entitlements. Mm-hmm. These major
we're not talking about them, though, right now,
no,
right?
That's why it's the biggest problem. The major problem we have as a country isn't that we're over... Isn't that we're undertaxed, it's that we're overspending. Mm-hmm. And it's a function of a demographic shift that's occurred. We're going to go from 35 million retired people to 70 million retired people as the baby boom generation, of which I'm a member, fully retires. And my generation will be technically fully retired by 2017, although it can't fully retire because it can't afford to.
Right.
But
exactly right.
The entitlement programs kick in. And the cost of those programs simply isn't affordable. Let me give you one statistic that shows why this is such a huge problem. All these major entitlement programs were set up as a pyramid where there'd be many more people paying in than taking out. And in the 1950s, 16 people paid into Social Security for every one person taking out. Mm-hmm. Today, 2 people pay in for every one person. We've gone from a pyramid to a rectangle. It's not supportable. And we're going to have to change. Now, that doesn't mean anything has to be done that's going to affect people who are on the system today in a draconian way or even a dramatic way. We have time to lead into this. The real substantive changes which should be done can have a lead time of 5, 10, 15 years. And as a result, people will be able to get ready for them, and they'll be really, in a sense, almost incremental. But they have to be done.
Mm-hmm. I want to shift gears for one second. Obviously, there's been a lot of conversation about the shootings in Newtown, Connecticut, and new conversation about gun control. What do you make of that conversation?
I think it's the easy way to try to address an incredibly difficult issue. You know, those shootings were just beyond comprehension. I mean, the horror of what happened. As a parent, and nobody can understand it. I mean, how can anybody shoot children? But there's a lot more to it than the gun. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a society which has, you know, lost its position for a lot of our people on right and wrong. You know, some people think there is no right and wrong. Everything's relative. Well, that's not true. There is a right and there is a wrong. And we're failing maybe to teach it to some members of our society. And you have these video games, which are incredibly violent, which kids become almost addicted to if they don't become addicted to. And certain personalities are going to go beyond the video game. And how do you handle that in a society that very puts great emphasis on freedom of speech and the First Amendment?
Are you going to have a lot of talk about this? Or is there anything you could even do?
There has to be something we can do. And I think it really has to come from people who are leaders in not only the government, but in the culture. Mm-hmm. Ecumenical leaders, people who are just involved in the community, mm-hmm. saying there is a right and a wrong, that our children need to be taught about that, and that we have to be, as a society, much less emphasis on violence.
I also want to ask you about one of your friends, former senator, or now deceased senator, Daniel Inouye from Hawaii. He's obviously resting in state last week. I saw somewhere he served with 412 U.S. senators, including 11 from New Hampshire, going all the way back to Norris Cotton.
I believe it.
Yeah, because I think he was first elected in 64 or something like that. So do you have any memories of him?
He was the most exceptional guy. Yeah. I mean, he was just exceptional.
Obviously Democrat. Yeah.
Across the aisle, of course, but I had great friends across the aisle, many, many great friends. I still have many good friends across the aisle. But he was just... First, he was just so nice. Mm-hmm. He was always pleasant. When I first arrived, you know, as an arriving member of the Senate, you don't have a whole lot of gravitas in the body. You're basically out there for a few years till people assess you.
He'd already been in the Senate for 30 years.
He'd been there for a huge amount of time.
Right.
And I got on his committee on appropriations very quickly through some luck. And he used to be so cordial to me. I mean, it was amazing. And then I ended up being chairman after like 3 years in the Senate. I ended up being chairman of Appropriations Subcommittee, which at that time meant a fair amount of responsibility and power. And it had one of the departments that he really was interested in. It had NOAA under it. And he would come by to talk to me about it. You know, I mean, he'd just stop in and start talking to me about it, which I was, you know, there was no ego at all. It was just such a nice, decent man. And of course, his record, the Senate was exceptional, and his war record was even more extraordinary. And when you think that he came out of the internment camps, you know, the fact that we had taken all the Japanese citizens in California, which was a very sad period in our history, and put them into internment camps, and he left that camp and fought with, I think it was the 44th, incredible story. And what he did in the actual engagements that he was involved in, and the wounds were extraordinary. Exceptional individual. And you know, I suspect your listeners know this, but in the hospital, when he was close to death, there was a person in the other bed who was equally close to death in the Italian theater, and the other person was Bob Dole.
Wow.
You know, and then that's where their friendship, which went on for all the years they were in the Senate and before that.
Well, obviously, you're a living political legend here in the state. What are you doing these days?
Well, Kathy and I are doing a lot of fun things. Spending a fair amount of time with our grandchildren,
good,
which we enjoy, and immensely, it's changed our life. And then I'm working with St. Anselm's.
Yep.
I'm also working up at Dartmouth and teaching up there, which I enjoy a lot.
What are you teaching there?
Well, they asked me to come in and speak to different courses that are touching some subject. I've done a course on the budget. I've done a course on elections and various things. And no formal course, just I come up about once a month and do something, or maybe twice a month. And then I'm on a couple of public boards and writing for the a newspaper in Washington, and also I'm a formal contributor to CNBC.
Sounds a lot more busy than you were in the Senate, probably.
Actually, in many ways it is, but I enjoyed the Senate. And we, Kathy and I, very much appreciate the fact that people in New Hampshire were kind enough to send us down there for so many years. But I don't miss their schedule in the Senate. And so it's nice to have my schedule, not Harry Reid's schedule.
And you're actually going to have a Christmas instead of those who were in Washington this year.
So I feel so bad.
Thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate it.
Pleasure.
And thank you for watching WMUR.com.